or good evening, good afternoon or good evening, everyone, depending on what time zone you are in. I would like to welcome you all to the second in our conversation series this semester. Before I introduce the speaker, a program notice that our next event, which is part of our Transatlantic Forum series, New Challenges, New Rights, will be held next Wednesday, the 23rd of March. And it will address the topic of biometrics, surveillance, and human rights issues with Dr. Matthias Weinroth from the University of Northumbria. More details on this to follow soon. I hope that you can all join us for this event. It is a great pleasure for me to welcome to our program Bill Schulz, who is currently a senior fellow at the Carr Center for Human Rights Policy at Harvard's Kennedy School of Government. Bill served as executive director of Amnesty International USA for 12 years. After leaving Amnesty, he held the position of senior fellow for human rights at the Center for American Progress. He taught human rights at NYU and served as president of the Unitarian Universalist Service Committee. He is also an ordained minister of the Unitarian Universalist Church, and he is the author or editor of 7 books on human rights. I invited Bill because he told me a while ago that he is writing his memoirs on his experiences as being on the front lines of human rights advocacy for decades. So I thought that would be a good opportunity, as he's working on his manuscript, to share some of his thoughts with us. And of course, I look very much forward to reading his book, which, as I understand from him, is scheduled for publication this coming fall. So without further ado, please welcome Bill Schulz, who is going to talk to us on hope, history, and human rights, lessons from the front lines. Please bear in mind that the session is being recorded, and you'll have an opportunity to ask questions at the end of Bill's remarks. And I would ask you all to put any questions that you may have on the chat function, okay? And we'll take them in the order in which they are received. So, Bill, thanks again for being with us today, and the floor is yours.
Thank you, George, and thanks for inviting me to this conversation. I want to address 4 topics: the dynamics of rescue, the need to build a larger constituency for human rights, when to use military force to stop human rights abuses, and the reasons for hope in the face of many obstacles and challenges, especially as we are seeing today. And I note among our audience, one of my predecessors as executive director of Amnesty, David Hawk. So David, you're welcome to correct me in anything that I say that is not in accord with your own perspective. As George said, I led Amnesty International USA from 1994 to 2006. And Amnesty's original stock in trade, of course, was freeing prisoners of conscience. And that is my first topic, the dynamics of rescue. This is an important topic, of course, because many human rights activities involve stopping the infliction of harm on other human beings, be that harm, torture, or starvation. Amnesty, during my years, claimed to have freed 40,000 prisoners of conscience. I was never able to find out where that number came from, but it sounded like a good number, and I repeated it over and over again. When it was founded in 1961, the organization defined a prisoner of conscience, a POC, as any person who is physically restrained by imprisonment or otherwise, from expressing in any words or symbols any opinion which he honestly holds, and who does not advocate or condone personal violence. Now, that sounds straightforward enough, but in fact, it's far more complicated than it sounds. In the first place, it means that even in the face of an enormously repressive political system, anyone who advocates the overthrow of that system may not be considered a prisoner of conscience. And this is why Nelson Mandela's POC status was revoked when in 1964, he supported the use of violence against the apartheid state. I often wondered, I have to say, if Klaus von Stauffenberg, who of course tried to assassinate Hitler, if he would have been denied POC status if amnesty had existed around 1944, even though Hitler's death would have averted hundreds of thousands of horrific human rights violations. So one lesson I learned very early on is that advancing human rights may not always be compatible with having absolutely clean hands. As the ethicist Joseph Fletcher asked, if the ends don't justify the means, then what does? So that's one problem with the POC conception. And here's another, that's the problem of politics. Because if amnesty was to defend any opinion which a person honestly holds, as long as the person does not employ violence, then a prisoner of conscience could theoretically even be an advocate of genocide. Here's an example. The Russian dissident Alexei Navalny, was first declared a POC. And then when it was discovered that he had made some xenophobic remarks in the past, that status was revoked, only to be reinstated a year or so ago with the clarification from Amnesty that designating someone a POC, quote, in no way implies endorsement of their views. Now, while that may be technically true, at the very least, those views are not supposed to involve hatred, of which one presumes xenophobia, such as Navalny's, is an example. Now, Navalny, of course, he's a heroic figure for whom I have great respect. Unfortunately, he's renounced his earlier views. But all this leads to a second lesson we can draw, which is that a hero or heroine's feet of clay need not obviate their greatness. Now, fortunately, most prisoners of conscience I knew were very admirable people. There's a wonderful story told about Kim Dae-jung, who was a POC and later served as president of South Korea from 1998 to 2003. And when Kim was under house arrest, one of the guards who had been assigned to paw through his garbage to find incriminating evidence of his disloyalty recalled that originally he had thought that Kim was an evil man because that's what his superiors had told him. And then one day he found a paper that Kim had written called Resolving Regional Hatreds. And this is what the guard said. I was deeply impressed by that paper. In fact, I thought Kim was a genius. I used to look forward to sorting through his garbage in hopes of finding more of his writings. But eventually the Kim family caught on and threw out nothing but wet stuff. I can't tell you how deeply disappointed I was. So some POCs can even earn the admiration of their captors, but most POCs are also extraordinarily principled and stubborn. Here's a good example. The fabled Russian physicist, Nobel Peace Prize recipient, and human rights campaigner Andrei Sakharov, a few years after he had been released from prison for criticizing the communist regime, I was invited to attend a luncheon to mark the launch of a new human rights foundation in Sakharov's name. And after the meal had been served, the host explained the purpose of the foundation, and then he invited Sakharov to endorse it. And Sakharov pulled himself up, and much to the host's consternation, he said, I'm sorry, but I can't say anything about the foundation because it has not done anything yet. I don't know if it is a good or bad thing. When it does something, then all of us will know and I will comment. Principled and stubborn. The mentality of most POCs is different from yours and mine. Most of us put a premium on personal security, if not comfort. Our principles matter to us, but not more than our family's welfare or our personal safety. But to most POCs, the cause trumps all else. Leyla Zana, for example, was prosecuted for wearing the Kurdish colors of red, yellow, and green and speaking a sentence in Kurdish, which is an outlawed language in Turkish, when she took the oath of office as a member of the Kurdish parliament. She didn't have to do that. She knew she and her family would suffer, but she did it anyway. Now, of course, such stubborn conviction can be very dangerous. Digna Ochoa was a courageous human rights lawyer, as well as a nun who regularly pursued cases against the Mexican police and military officials. She defended the Zapatistas of Chiapas when they were accused of crimes against the state. Having been abducted and tortured, the subject of constant death threats, Digna took refuge in the United States. And in 2000, the actor Martin Sheen and I presented her with Amnesty's Enduring Spirit Award in Los Angeles. It was a festive evening. Digna felt safe, honored. But like so many human rights advocates, she could not stay away from her community, no matter how much danger lurked there. She returned to Mexico City and took up her work again, but this time she paid with her life. In October, she was shot dead. In October of 2001, she was shot dead in her office, wounds in her leg and her head. A note left warning her human rights colleagues that a similar fate could befall them. Now, absurdly, Mexican officials claimed that she had committed suicide. Despite the note, despite the fatal bullet having entered the left side of her head, though Digna was right-handed, despite the wound to her leg, which under the suicide theory must have been a practice shot before she shot herself in the head. So a third lesson we might draw is that one ought to never underestimate the venality or folly of human rights offending regimes. In China, the state made the families of those it executed, made them pay for the bullet that killed their loved ones. And when security officials in Nepal returned a political prisoner to his home, they insisted that his wife sign a return receipt for the package of her husband. It's really rather remarkable then that over the years, tens of thousands of people in Amnesty have experienced strong enough feelings of solidarity to try to help POCs, perfect strangers who find themselves under duress. This is one of the most admirable things about the organization. But of course, defending a few individuals is not enough to stop widespread human rights crimes like racism or famine or indeed genocide. And that leads to my second and third topics, how to build a larger constituency for human rights in this country and when to use force to stop force. The human rights community has always been reticent to call for the use of military intervention to combat human rights violations. But the very first crisis which I faced upon becoming head of Amnesty in 1994 was the genocide in Rwanda, and that forced me to shift my thinking about intervention rather dramatically. I don't need to, I'm sure, to this audience repeat a description of what happened when 800,000 some people, largely members of the Tutsi tribe, were slaughtered in Rwanda. And neither Amnesty nor any other human rights organization was able to do anything to convince the United States to support a request by the UN commander on the ground in Rwanda, Romeo Dallaire, for 5,000 more troops, which he believed would be enough to stop a slaughter that was being carried on largely through the use of machetes and other very primitive devices. The fundamental problem in the United States was that virtually nobody cared. When representatives of Human Rights Watch, for example, secured an appointment with Anthony Lake, who was then President Clinton's national security advisor, and begged him to support the UN intervention, Lake shrugged his shoulders and he told them, if you want to make US policy move, you have to change public opinion. You have to use more noise. In other words, he was telling them that if the administration was to do the right thing, it had to be forced to do it by putting pressure on people and by putting people in the states. He was saying, we don't intend to expend any political capital by leading. But Human Rights Watch had no grassroots constituency, and Amnesty could not turn out thousands and thousands of people into the streets to protest a genocide in a country that even Secretary of State Warren Christopher required an atlas to locate. The fact is that fewer than 10% of Americans born in this country were fluent in a second language back in the early 2000s. America's attention to the world beyond our shores is distinctly underwhelming. In 1997, just 15% of Americans held passports. Two-thirds said that what happened in other countries had no impact on their lives. How were we to overcome this American indifference and build a larger constituency for human rights? Well, I saw only three ways to do that. First, to evoke a moral consciousness by telling what the philosopher Richard Rorty called sentimental stories, poignant, touching stories of real people that make other people sit up and say, I know that feeling, that could be me. In this way, we evoke what Rorty called solidarity, which he described as the ability to see more and more traditional differences of tribe or religion or race as unimportant when compared with similarities with respect to pain and humiliation. Sure, not everyone will respond to those sentimental stories. According to the historian Margaret Macmillan, women at Hitler's mountain home of Berchtesgaden ate the gravel he had just walked on. Well, people like that, people that devoted to evil, are inured to sentiment. We could have told the Hutu genocidaires in Rwanda hundreds of stories about the Tutsis, and it wouldn't have stopped the massacres. The Tutsis had been defined as outside the circle of humanness, of humanness itself. But stories, therefore, are not enough to mobilize large numbers of people for human rights. The second thing that is needed is to draw the connection between human rights violations and American self-interest. For many Americans, human rights is seen as an esoteric, even an elitist cause. And to reverse that, we in the human rights community need to appeal to the machinist who fears the loss of his job to a country that denigrates labor rights, or the mother who trembles for her child's life in a military unit at risk of being the target of war crimes. We need to reach the consumer who doesn't want to buy products tainted by child labor, and the taxpayer who doesn't want tax dollars wasted on foreign military assistance that ends up subsidizing torture and political killings. We need people to understand that the odds for transmission of disease from one country to another increase dramatically when the source country stifles a free media and intimidates whistleblowers, as happened so dramatically in China with the outbreak of COVID-19 in 2019. And to do all this means to put human rights talk in language everybody understands, and welcome to the struggle a far more diverse constituency, racially, economically, and politically, than that which made up the typical Amnesty audience, which tended to be white, middle class, and left wing. And the third thing we needed to do was to create a larger constituency for human rights, was to build alliances with other institutions of power. The movement against apartheid in South Africa, for example, had been materially aided by international campaigns encouraging divestment in South African corporations like De Beers, or boycotts of sporting events in which South Africa was scheduled to take part. Students played a major role in the anti-sweatshop campaign against Nike, and celebrities regularly used their visibility and reach to highlight human rights abuses in Darfur, Sudan, as George Clooney and Don Cheadle did. Had we done all this, we might have been able to convince the U.S. to support military intervention in Rwanda. I don't know, but we would have had at least a better shot than we did at the time. Which leads to another of my four topics, this question of when to use force to intervene to stop human rights violations. As a child of the anti-Vietnam War era, I had been reflexively skeptical of the use of military power. I understood all the reasons why Amnesty and other human rights organizations were reticent to make such a call. For one thing, military force often exacerbates human rights abuses. But the insistence on hands that bore no blemish at all gave cover to those whose hands were dripping in blood. So when should we use force to stop human rights crimes? First, those crimes must be massive and widespread, sufficient to, in the famous words, shock the conscience of humankind. Second, if there is time, coercive options other than military force ought to be tried first. Third, the objectives of intervention must be clear and have a high likelihood of success. Force must be limited to stopping the atrocities and be applied proportionally. And finally, there must be an exit strategy that is likely to leave the country better off rather than worse. Often the United States is not the most appropriate country to lead a humanitarian military intervention. And even when it is always better to have a coalition of forces, especially from the region. And some international body needs to authorize the action, even if it is not the United Nations. All these criteria call for tough judgment, but had Romeo Dallaire been correct that 5,000 troops could have put an end to the butchery of 800,000 people in Rwanda, there is no moral calculus in the world by which that would not be an obligatory investment. These criteria were appropriately applied in one of the most successful military interventions in recent history, an intervention that has almost been forgotten today, and that is the war in Kosovo. I believe that that was a righteous war that met the criteria I just outlined for a defensible humanitarian intervention, though I never said that publicly since Amnesty's position was to take no position on such matters. In 2000, an independent international commission on Kosovo set up by the government of Sweden to assess NATO's actions essentially agreed. The commission concluded that the NATO intervention was illegal, but legitimate. It was illegal because it did not receive approval from the UN Security Council, but it was legitimate because all diplomatic avenues had been exhausted and there was no other way to stop the killings. Well, finally, I want to speak of this question of hope, particularly an important question today in the face of what is happening in Kosovo. Despite all that has happened in the last 20, 30 years, I retain a significant degree of hope for human rights. Some years ago, I paid a visit to Syracuse University to give a lecture. And before the lecture, the president of the university and a group of faculty members entertained me at dinner. And the president said, after dessert had been served, he said, "Let's ask ourselves this question. Are human rights better or worse off today than they were 200 years ago?" And with one exception, the faculty members all insisted that human rights were worse off today than they had been in the early 1800s. And finally, I could contain myself no longer. And in my customarily tactful way, I said, are you folks serious? Just in the years I've been with Amnesty, we've seen the creation of the International Criminal Court, the war crimes tribunals for the former Yugoslavia and Rwanda, a proliferation of local human rights groups in virtually every country on the planet, rape in the course of war declared a war crime, women's rights taken more seriously than ever before. The British law lords rule that sovereign immunity does not prevent the prosecution of dictators like Chile's Augusto Pinochet. Worldwide condemnation of the US use of torture in Iraq. The US Supreme Court having ruled unconstitutional the execution of juveniles and those with intellectual disabilities. And you don't think that human rights are better off today than in 1806, when slavery was still enshrined in the US Constitution and serfs still toiled the steppes of Russia? The question I was asked most frequently and have been over my years in human rights is this: how can you stand it? I mean, every day your job requires you to see, to read about, to hear about human beings treating each other like garbage, raping, torturing, killing, mutilating. It's just too much. How can you stand it, all the pain and death? How do you retain even the slightest faith in the goodness of humanity? Any hope for the future of human rights? So let me conclude the formal part of these remarks by trying to fashion an answer. It's true, of course, that the adversaries of human rights have a great deal of political, economic, and military power, far more than those who would uphold human rights standards. Yet it is also true that the deployment of that political, economic, and military power is largely wielded in accordance with cultural norms. Sometimes those norms reinforce parochialism, particularly in a nation that is isolated or feels under threat, as Russia apparently does at the moment. But at the global level, where all voices can be heard, it is a very different story. At the global level, human beings have created cultural norms, human rights norms, that define the nature of a good society and are about as widely accepted a measure of what it means to be civil as we humans have yet invented. Now, how can I say that? Because the tyrants themselves give the game away. It's certainly true that there are a few leaders, perhaps Kim Jong-un of North Korea is one, who may not care what the world thinks of them. Maybe we think Putin is one today. But even in the case of Putin, why does he feel the need to deny that he is committing war crimes? Why did he feel the need to construct an elaborate rationale based on alleged genocide of Russian ethnics in Ukraine to justify his war there, his invasion? Why does he pretend that he was elected democratically? Why does he deny that he poisoned his political opponent, Alexei Navalny? Or take some others. Why does China's Xi Jinping label his detention camps friendly vocational training centers? That's a quote. If he's proud of his re-education through labor camps, why doesn't he advertise them on Chinese television? Why does China claim that it has its, quote, own variety of democracy, rather than just revel in its authoritarianism? As Sarah Cook of Freedom House put it, the fact that the Chinese regime feels the need to consistently justify its political system in terms of democracy is a powerful acknowledgement of the symbolism and legitimacy that the term democracy holds. Why did Saudi Prince Mohammed bin Salman pretend he had nothing to do with the dismembering of Washington Post columnist Jamal Khashoggi? If Khashoggi was an evildoer, why not just trumpet his just deserts? Why does Hungary's Viktor Orban call himself an illiberal Democrat, but still a Democrat rather than a self-avowed authoritarian? Why does the Myanmar military insist it will eventually introduce free elections? When was the last time a country invited a CNN news crew into its torture chambers? Certainly Genghis Khan or Tamerlane or Ivan the Terrible or Lenin or Idi Amin would have had no such compunctions as all of these people have. I could offer dozens more examples of the subterfuges engaged by autocrats, but the key question is why? Why do these powerful masters of the universe want to hide their dirty deeds? The answer is because they know that their actions are at odds with the defining characteristics of a civilized society. Sometimes there will be consequences, internal or external, for defying those norms. Young people in the streets, corporations too skittish to make investments, allies too embarrassed to maintain relations, an indictment by an international or a foreign court. Often there will not be any repercussions, but the autocrats can never be sure. And consequences or not, the norms and the shame and the worry remain. Now, many people will wonder, of course, what good moral norms and human rights standards do if they can be violated with flagrant impunity. It's a common challenge to human rights advocates, and it's a good question. But an equally good question is, where would we be without them? Do we really want to live in a world in which killing your political enemies, cleansing your nation of ethnic minorities, torturing your captives are not behaviors subject to rebuke? Do we prefer a world in which exploitation of the poor and harsh treatment of the powerless are considered things to be proud of? If the standard for hope in human rights is the appearance of a perfectly just world, then hope is doomed. But I am not looking for a just world. I am looking for a less unjust one, not a world of pure virtue, but a world of less wickedness. As the critic Susan Sontag wrote in her diary, the only transformation that interests me is a total transformation, however minute. If the goal is not a perfect world, but a less unjust one, then I think the odds in favor of human rights are maybe 60-40. Indeed, if we take the measure of our world in generations and not year to year, I think the odds improve on 60-40. In 1948, when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted, more than 50% of the world lived in extreme poverty. Today, that number is less than 10%. In 1948, the death penalty was in widespread use around the world. Today, almost three quarters of the world's nations have abolished the practice. Freedom House has noted that the number of countries it considers not free has grown by 9 in the past 15 years, and that is indeed worrisome. But in 1948, there were only 20 democracies in the whole world, and today there are close to 100. In the 1940s, 60% of African-American women worked as domestic servants. Today, that percentage is 2.2%, with 60% in white-collar jobs. In 1948, no woman had ever headed a government. There were no international conventions prohibiting genocide, torture, racial discrimination, or any number of other grievous wrongs. Apartheid, South Africa was thriving, Eastern Europe was smothering, and even Eleanor Roosevelt, who chaired the committee that authored the UDHR and was herself involved in a lesbian relationship, even Eleanor Roosevelt could not have fathomed that marriage might not be reserved for a man and a woman. Perhaps no other human rights arena better illustrates the advances that have been made since 1948 than that of international justice. As of 2020, the two war crimes tribunals for Rwanda and the former Yugoslavia, as well as the International Criminal Court, had indicted 289 people and convicted 159 of genocide, war crimes, and crimes against humanity, 159 people who otherwise would likely never have been punished. and just as importantly, the principle of universal jurisdiction, the notion that any national court may try a suspect for serious breaches of even of international law, even if that suspect is not a national of that state, is being applied more and more frequently. In 2016, Senegal and the African Union, for example, convicted the former dictator of Chad of war crimes and sentenced him to life in prison where he died. In the summer of 2021, a Swedish court began hearing a case related to the massacre of 5,000 prisoners under the orders of the newly elected Iranian president, Ebrahim Raisi. And about 6 months later, a German court convicted a former Syrian security officer of crimes against humanity and sentenced him to life in prison. Now, let me conclude by saying this. The point of all of this that I've just recited is not to sow satisfaction, for I know as well as anyone how many hideous injustices remain, and we see them every single day today. But I also know two things about history. First, I know that history is not determined by either the whims of an angry God or the prophecies of an economic fate, that it is shaped by a thousand things, but among those are human hands. It has rarely taken a majority to make a revolution. Revolutions are made by a devoted, well-placed, and strategic few. I saw Slobodan Milosevic's government fall in October 2000, thanks in no small part to the perseverance of the largely student-led organization known as OTPOR. And second and finally, I know that history is not just one damn thing after another, as Huxley is supposed to have said. History builds upon itself, one generation's experience influencing another for good or ill. The fact that human beings had the imagination to envision the human rights ideal in the first place means that we know where we want to go, even if we stumble in the process. We know through long centuries of trial and error what it means to act with honor. Barbarism is not inevitable. Benevolence is not impossible. And hope is not a pipe dream if we build on the wisdom of our ancestors and try to make the world not a perfect place, but just a bit more kind. So be it.
Thank you, Bill, for this powerful and keeping hope alive, you know, which is badly needed at this point. I do not yet see any questions on the chat, and I would encourage you to... I just saw one came in. Okay, I was going to ask some, but I just saw one a question come in, and this is from Joseph. Your examples of authoritarians fabricating their actions are fascinating. If these leaders feel guilt or understand their wrongdoing, how do we see the international community best striving towards accountability? Would it be by strengthening the international criminal courts, promoting global issues on local news? And do you see the type of sanctions being placed on Russia as a new precedent for the world community? Bill.
So the simple answer is all of the above. I think that if anything has proven the disastrous consequences of the United States not having entered into the Rome Statutes with regard to the International Criminal Court, what's happening today in Ukraine proves them without the need for much further debate. So certainly international judicial and accountability structures are important, but obviously those take a long time. And so if in fact the West, NATO and its allies are successful in putting enough pressure on Putin currently to ratchet down his behavior, and that of course is so far a big if, then yes, this will be a critically important new development in the quiver of those of us who want to see a more regulated and structured world in terms of human rights violations, to say nothing of these kinds of horrendous war crimes and crimes against humanity. So indeed, I think we are at a critical juncture in many, many ways. And if we can avoid nuclear war, and if we can find our way out of this horrendous mess that we're currently in, then I think it will be incumbent and there will be some motivation for the international community, with or without Russia and China, to reorganize itself in terms of, I don't mean the creation of new international organizations, but reanimate itself, perhaps that's a better word, in terms of creating a variety of structures and vehicles for intervention. And those ultimately, as I've said, may in some context include military intervention, though obviously in this case that is fraught with horrendous potential consequences. And in my judgment, to this point, the Biden administration has been wise in the limits that it's placed in that respect.
Okay. I see no other questions. So let me jump in with a couple of comments. First of all, Bill, thank you for your very informative and passionate and insightful remarks. The first question I have on the Kosovo report that you mentioned, as I'm sure you are aware, the distinction between legitimacy and legality was the contribution of Richard Folks in that report. And Richard is a good friend of mine, and I have discussed this issue extensively with him. How do you address that drawing this distinction between legality and legitimacy reinforces the danger of co-optation of the human rights discourse by those most willing to use force, and they will increasingly resort to human rights related arguments to justify causes that have nothing to do with human rights? That's my first question.
Let me take that question before you go on to the next one, so I can remember all the nuances of your questions. So first I have to say, you have to know that I am the son of a law professor who chose to go into the ministry and into philosophy rather than law. And that might give you a hint that my concern is far more for legitimacy than legality, though I obviously am not going to dismiss the importance of the rule of law. Of course, I could not do that. You've pointed out an obvious concern, which is how do we avoid the types of situations in which we found ourselves in the Iraq war, for example, where the administration tried to use Amnesty's own reports of human rights violations to justify what was clearly an unjustifiable intervention. And Amnesty appropriately, and other human rights organizations, Human Rights Watch and others, spoke out appropriately at that time on the misuse of those particular reports. And that's why I tried to outline very, very briefly, it's been done far more thoroughly elsewhere, but I tried to outline in my remarks some of the criteria that I think, and they're fairly strict criteria, that I think need to be met before an intervention is undertaken. And one of those criteria is that the end product, the goal, needs to be not one of self-interest, but one of the actual termination of human rights violations going on that shock the conscience. And I think that was clearly not the case in the Iraq war, and we could point to any number of other cases. But the reason I raise the Kosovo war is because I think it is a very interesting example of a war where there was relatively little, very little of self-interest to be gained by NATO intervention there. There certainly was no interest in oil. There was no interest overthrowing Milosevic, as there was in the case of Iraq. There was, I think, a fairly straightforward recognition that if NATO didn't intervene there, a lot of innocent people were going to be killed. And it was an intervention that was proportional. Yes, there was the unfortunate bombing of the Chinese embassy. Yes, there were a few civilian deaths, but remarkably few for that kind of an intervention. it was done, I think, with a great deal of responsibility and conscience. And in that sense, I think it is something that is worth more reflection than it has received.
Okay. The other question I have, there are many, but I'm just going to ask one because I see also other questions are coming in now. You mentioned that the bar that we should set, if I may use that expression, is not a perfect world, but a less unjust world. And of course, this I would have no problems with this argument. However, it seems that we may be entering now another phase in which we see some serious backsliding in human rights advancement. And I think because although we have made some progress, it seems that we have been going through a roller coaster ride. We had this decade of the 90s in which human rights exploded and everybody was using them, including leaders of authoritarian regimes. Then we have the war on terror and the space shrinks. Now, we are yet entering another phase in which, after the Biden administration comes to power, and I want to ask your thoughts about the current developments and how this may affect human rights space. Was a promise again, we'll re-engage with the world, with international institutions, rejoin the Human Rights Council and blah, blah, blah. But now we have the invasion of Ukraine, and you see that the administration, in order to contain Russia, is embracing everybody who can contribute to forming an united anti-Russia front, including countries like Poland, Hungary, Turkey, who are well-known backsliders. In fact, as you probably know, in the summit of democracy that Biden had, did not even invite Hungary and Turkey, and I'm surprised why he'd invite Poland, but we can argue that some other time. Or he's embracing Venezuela because he needs the oil. So in this kind of a situation, how does the human rights movement react to reverse or at least contain this backsliding, which I'm afraid is going to be with us for some time, because now the overwhelming event that is shaping developments is how to contain Russia.
So, George, I guess I would ask the following rhetorical question. Does that mean that during the Second World War, we should refuse to have allied ourselves with Stalin's Russia against Hitler? I think that of course, in the face of a catastrophe like this, one can't always choose only those allies who have the purest of hands. But I think the lesson of the Second World War alliances was that the mistakes that were made after the war was ended, when a very sick Roosevelt and a Churchill, who was politically damaged at home, made various concessions to Stalin, which didn't, in fact, advance the Atlantic Charter and the ideals which Winston Churchill and Roosevelt had presumably stood for. So I think that that will be the same test here, George, I guess, is how I would respond to your question. You're absolutely right. Turkey, Poland, Hungary. Yes, but it will be very interesting to see whether those countries may recognize that their own interests do not lie in further distancing themselves from democratic regimes and values in this particular case. They may, in fact, come to a magnificent new vision, come to Jesus, as it were, with regard to some of these values that they have been trampling upon. But even if they don't, it will be incumbent upon the allies to continue the kind of pressure that they have been bringing to bear on Poland, the European Union and so on, bringing to bear upon Poland and Hungary and to a lesser extent, Turkey, with regard to their violations of these fundamental values. Mm-hmm. So okay. I hope that it is a short-term alliance of convenience. And I think it is probably defensible as that, but it will not be defensible if that remains the only objection that we have.
Okay, thank you. All right, we have a question from Rui Marquez. Magnificent event. My question is, Have human rights always been seen as more of a political instrument than humanitarian or otherwise? And is it positive to say that human rights is a political instrument?
Well, that's a very, very interesting question. So on the one hand, here is my simple definition of human rights. Human rights are create the vision of the good society based upon our conception of human dignity. Now, it's a lot more complicated than that, but for our purposes, if we understand human rights to be a description of the good society grounded in our conceptions of human dignity, then on the one hand, that vision, that ideal is of a moral and sociological composition. But how do we get there? That's a political question. A political question, an economic question, a military question, as I've just been discussing with George. So I think the answer is that human rights has always been both. It's always been an expression of human achievement. The State Department called the UDHR, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, an aspirational statement, and it has been that. But if it is only aspirational, well, we know those of us who break our New Year's resolutions the next day know how useless aspirational statements alone are. And if it is not accompanied by such things as the creation of international courts, by a UN Human Rights Council that actually works, by human rights organizations that are telling the truth and disclosing what's going on in the back alleys and the prisons of, if these political dimensions are not coupled with that aspirational or moral dimension, then they are useless, relatively useless. And that's why I've argued here both for human rights as a cultural ideal. I think it is that, and that's critically important because cultural ideals create norms. But I've also said that we need a bigger constituency for human rights, and we need clarity about how to intervene militarily, economically, and in other respects to make them a reality.
Okay, the next question comes from my colleague Nerva Makasbak, who also happens to be a senior researcher for Amnesty International. So he's asking you a couple of things. If you could speak more about the dynamics between the UK Secretariat, Amnesty's Secretariat in London, and Amnesty International USA in terms of forming the discourses, programs, and policies of Amnesty International to specific human rights cases. That is basically how do this entity, the International Secretariat and Amnesty International USA, how do they interact when it comes to formulating policy on these issues? And if you could speak also more specifically about Amnesty International USA's efforts to link human rights violation happening within the US, that is homelessness, income inequality, deaths and murders of African American, anti-Asian hate, with the global human rights situation and global campaigns. So how does the local relate to the global in the context of campaigning and formulating the appropriate discourses?
So two very good questions, and I want to try to avoid getting too much into the Amnesty weeds here because we have, I'm sure, a lot of people who are not necessarily all that interested in Amnesty politics. And then I have to say, of course, I left Amnesty in 2006, so I can only comment on the situation back then. So it always struck me that the model that Amnesty adopted, which was that there would be a strong central authority, which happened to be based in London, and there would be then circling that authority, dozens of national sections, satellites, or colonies, as it were, that this model was very reminiscent of British colonialism, British imperialism. And it wasn't a surprise that this was an organization, Amnesty International, that was founded by Brits and that was founded in the UK. And what this meant was that there was continual tension between those in the colonies, that is the national sections, including Amnesty USA, and the central authority, which wanted to keep control as best it could of Amnesty policies, of Amnesty's reports, of Amnesty's findings. One of the ways that that manifested itself was that initially, for many, many years, Amnesty had a restrictive rule which required that there be no work by a national section on human rights violations committed in its own country. That we in the United States could not research, work on, or be active in opposing such things as US police brutality, various other forms of racism in housing and education, and so on. That only people in Denmark or India or Australia could work on US issues, and similarly, we could only work on issues in other countries around the world. Now, this was designed, of course, to keep Amnesty politically neutral in a local political context, but it always struck me as incredibly self-defeating. And in fact, it reaches into the second part of the question here, because the second part of the question is, what is the relationship between human rights violations in the United States and those internationally, and how do those connect? We know very well that to the extent to which the United States as a government fails to live up to its own ideals, that this weakens the US's ability to establish itself as a model for other countries around the world and weakens its ability to be seen as a legitimate leader. We know very well that all of the ways in which persons of color have been mistreated in this country have done enormous damage to the reputation of the United States as it tries to extend its leadership around the world. And so for Amnesty to discourage people in the United States Amnesty section from working against racism or against homelessness or against domestic violence or whatever it might be here in the United States, the one exception, by the way, was that one could work against the death penalty. To discourage us from working on all those other things was not only to limit our own constituency for Amnesty here in this country, but it was also to make it far more difficult for the United States to be a leader internationally. Fortunately, during the years that I was there, that rule was very significantly relaxed, and gradually relations between the local section and the international movement improved. But there is, I'm sure, within the organization, and there will always remain, this tension between a central headquarters, even though it's now much more diversified in terms of its locations, but a central headquarters which needs to create, or thinks that it needs to create, one clear direction, plumb line, value set, and a bunch of colonies, sections that are reacting within their own context. So this tension, I'm sure, continues to exist, but it was certainly part of what I dealt with when I was there.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Anybody? Okay, if I may jump in again, and ask you another question. I have many, but I promise you that's my last question, Bill. Although we'll continue the conversation. I'm very well familiar with the incident that you mentioned in 1994 when representatives of human rights organization went to see Tony Lake, and he said, basically, where is your mass appeal or whatever, which demonstrated that some of these established organizations have become very professional, very articulate. Sometimes I say jokingly, when I walk into the offices of some major human rights organizations. I'm not going to mention any names. I feel I'm going into the headquarters of a corporate law firm, as opposed to an organization, basically, which is trying to change the world. This clearly professionalization has really delinked the human rights movement from broader constituencies. From your experience, what else do you see as the drawbacks, not the advantages, the drawbacks of the increasing professionalization of human rights advocacy in the global north?
So, to the extent to which there is a corporatization of any nonprofit, social justice nonprofit, obviously that creates a whole series of challenges in terms, for example, of keeping donors happy, in terms of making sure that enough money continues to flow in to make it possible to maintain those offices or to maintain those financial reports, whatever it may be. And I think any grassroots organization like Amnesty is constantly struggling, and understandably so, between that grassroots energy, which one wants to harness, and the reality that in order to harness it, in order to harness the energy of tens of thousands of people, you need to pay some people, namely staff, to help do that in an effective way. And that tension is always there. My observation, I can only speak of human rights NGOs here. I can't speak about other social justice NGOs, but my observation is that almost all of the larger human rights organizations have done a pretty good job of recognizing that their principal calling is to effect human rights change. It's not simply to maintain the organization or to increase its financial value or to understand it as a corporate entity. For the most part, for example, the human rights movement gets very little support from the business community, financial support, I mean. Amnesty got virtually none. Human Rights Watch, I don't know, but they certainly, that is not the principal place from which their funding comes. They have a cadre of very powerful individuals and foundations that support them. And that is true of the Lawyers Committee. It's now called Human Rights First. It was then called the Lawyers Committee for Human Rights, now Human Rights First, and all of the major human rights organizations, Physicians for Human Rights, and so on. So I have not found, George, that that has been a serious problem, though obviously one wants to always guard against it and recognize that we are dealing here with life and death issues. I mean, I think a greater problem is that human rights advocates don't take enough time to celebrate their victories, because, you know, I used to see part of my job going around the office and telling people to go home at the end of the day, because, you know, when you're working to save people's lives, you feel, I've just got to do one more thing. I've just got to try one more effort. And at the end of the day, if you yourself don't have the energy or the strength, because you've exhausted yourself at this work, then that's not going to do any good for anybody. So I think it's a danger, corporatization, but it's not one that I am concerned about in terms of the long run, the human rights movement.
Okay. I think we have time for one more question, if anybody has, before we let anybody. Okay. Hearing none, I'm seeing none. I am sure you will all join me in thanking Bill. First of all, for the sense of energy and optimism, Bill, you know, because this is badly needed during this period. Anyhow, I hope you and I can discuss sometime the implication of what is happening now, because I am afraid that the implications of the war in Ukraine are going to be with us much longer. I personally see it as another 9/11 moment, but let's see whether that happens or not. We'll have to wait and see. Anyhow, thank you very much for—
Thank you, George. Pleasure. Yeah, thanks to all of you for coming.
For your insightful remarks and very informative remarks and the way you addressed our queries and questions. And thank you all of you for being with us this afternoon. And for those of you who may have joined us late, just a very quick reminder, program note, please join us for our next session of the Transatlantic Forum on Biometric Surveillance and Human Rights Issues next Wednesday, the 23rd at 1:30 in the afternoon, featuring Dr. Matthias Weinroth from the University of Northumbria. Without further ado, have a nice afternoon, evening, depending on your time zone, and we'll see you hopefully a week from today. Bye-bye. And Bill, thanks again.
Thank you, George.